Well, good evening, everyone. It's so good to see everyone here. My name is Brenton McGee, and I am the Performing Arts Associate here at Friends Home in Kennett. And it's my joy to have these music lectures where we bring people all over the world to speak. And we are really excited and stuff. We've just started this program a little bit in June, and we've had performers all over the world. But these two dear friends are special friends of mine because I know them personally, not just someone I met on Zoom. These are wonderful individuals, and I want to introduce them, and then they are going to present themselves. So this session's Meet the Musician series guests, lecture guests, are Alexis Renee Ward, who is the composer, and Ryan Pryslak, the director of music. And what they are presenting for us is a new Advent cantata that Alexis Renee Ward wrote, and Ryan Pryslak is going to conduct. It's going to be Sunday, December 12th, and it will be on Facebook. I don't know about YouTube, but it will be live streamed for anybody to watch and also in person. So I'll read their bios, and the floor is theirs. Alexis Renee Ward is an award-winning composer, arranger, conductor, singer, music educator, and accompanist. Her teaching and directing experience runs throughout the ages, and her experience levels in both vocal and instrumental fields. For over 15 years, Alexis has worked extensively in sacred music and the nonprofit sector, conducting amateur to professional level community choirs and orchestras, church choirs, children's choirs, handbells, praise bands, folk ensembles, theater troupes, and chamber groups. She received both her Bachelor of Music degree in composition music theory, as well as her Master of Music degree in choral conducting at the University of Delaware, and is currently completing the requirements for her master's in composition. She currently serves as the director of music at Trinity Presbyterian Church, artistic director at Chester River Chorale, assistant director of Concordia Choral Arts, and creator co-founder of the Sonus School of Music. She resides in North Delaware with her husband, Thomas, daughter Hazel, and one more on the way, and I think she's going to be here in April, the daughter, so we're very happy for Alexis. And then Ryan Pryslak has served as the organist and director of music ministries at Church of the Covenant since June of 2017. He is a graduate of the University of Delaware with a Bachelor's of Arts in Music, majoring in voice and choral conducting with a minor in church music. Ryan's role oversees all aspects of music and worship in conjunction with the pastor and worship and arts committee, which includes providing music for all worship services, holy days and feasts, weddings and funerals, directing the Covenant Choir, which I'm privileged to be a part of, and they offer anthems and other service music during worship throughout the year, and coordinating the Covenant Handbell Ensemble. In 2017, Ryan began the event popular Arts at Covenant Concert Series, which is now in its fourth season and provides accessible performing arts events to the North Wilmington area, as well as educational opportunities for youth and adults alike in the Bellefonte and Eagamore communities. Ryan and his lovely wife, Jessica, are parents to two children, Grayson and Addison, and they reside in Wilmington, Delaware. So without further ado, here is Ryan Pryslak and Alexis Renee Ward. Yay. So I'm going to share the screen, and I am going to make you the host.
Thank you, Brenton. Well, thanks, everyone. It's a delight. There we go. I'm here. Can everyone see me okay? There we go.
We can see you fine. We can see you fine.
Excellent. Well, it's a delight to be here tonight. Brenton, thank you for having me speak at this lecture. And it's just a joy to discuss the upcoming performance, the world premiere of Covenant Advent Vespers, which Alexis Ward has composed. As you mentioned earlier, before we started, Alexis is not going to be able to be here in person tonight. But in just a short bit, we have a really great video of her from earlier today that we're going to share about her compositional process, about how she composed the piece. And she's going to sort of give you a little bit of a preview of the piece as well. So what I thought I would do before we began, you know, launching into the discussion, the video with Alexis, is I wanted to give you sort of a historical background of what Vespers are. So back in 2017, when I started at Covenant, and I started the Arcs of Covenant series, the church didn't really have any kind of sort of Advent or Lenten program per se that, any kind of cantata or different sort of event. And what I decided to do was something a little bit different than what some other churches in the area were doing. Some churches were doing, you may have heard of a Lessons and Carols service around Christmas. Many churches do cantatas either at Christmas or Easter or Lent. And what I decided to do was start a Advent Vespers. And it's basically an evening service that takes place during the season of Advent. And what I want to talk about now is why did I choose that? And what is Vespers? And historically, how was that developed over the centuries of Western music? So one of the things that, if you're a lover of music, whether you study music, whether you enjoy choral music, symphonic music, anything like that, if we take a step back to when sort of modern music, I don't mean modern what we hear on the radio, but sort of the modern age of music was created, everything sort of stems out of the church. So back in the 13, 1400s, in the medieval ages, everything that was sung, anything that was played, well, let's say anything that was sung had to do with being involved in the church. And it slowly developed from there to become more secular as it went on. But even through Middle Ages, the Renaissance period in the 15, 1600s, into what we call the Baroque period during the 1700s, or late early 1700s, everything was really geared towards the church. It wasn't until the late Baroque period that opera came about. And things started to turn away from the church and become a little more secular. So when we talk about music in the church and we look at those sort of the core, the background, we look at what music was the centerpiece for worship. And back, you know, as far back as the Middle Ages and then into the Renaissance, and even before the Middle Ages, there were Christian scholars like Hippolytus, that's a name he may or may not know, that wrote that a Christian should pray 7 times a day. And that's pretty common, a common theme in many of the major religions, whether it's Islam, whether it's Judaism, whether it's, you know, a Far Eastern religion, that praying throughout the day was something that brought you closer to God. And as that time went on, you had people in monastic communities like St. Benedict, St. Francis, many others that developed what we call a rule. And that rule is basically how they live their life. And when we get to one of the most important, St. Benedict, he creates the rule of St. Benedict, which was probably the strictest rule of that time, where there are 7 times a day that you should pray. And it's literally from morning into the evening and overnight. So if you were living in a monastic community, you would be praying 7 times a day. You wouldn't sleep much. So one of those 7 times a day was called Vespers. It came before what we call comp line, the late night service comp line was probably about 9 or 10 o'clock. Vespers came probably around twilight into the early evening when the sun was setting and it was getting dark. And back then, of course, there was no electricity. So candles had to be lit. And Vespers actually comes from the Greek root I think it's vespera or vespere, which means evening. And when this service, this evening prayer service was created back in the Middle Ages, it had a structure. And from the time of Saint Benedict through the Renaissance into what we call the Reformation with Martin Luther, and even to the Counter-Reformation, where the Catholic Church sort of reformed their music, their liturgy, in response to Martin Luther, it was pretty much the same way. And Vespers itself always followed a pattern. It would have an opening sentence, so basically a prayer that was said or often chanted by monks. It would have what we call versicles and responses. So the abbot of the monastery would chant or pray, let's say some sort of prayer, and it would be responded to by the entire congregation, the entire group of monks. Often it was simple chant, but maybe for feast days, maybe for Christmas, for example, or during Holy Week, those chants tended to get more complex. Remember back in the Middle Ages, when this started, there was no what we call polyphony, no what we call homophony. It was one voice in unison singing. So we also have psalms, and we know what the psalms are basically songs from the Old Testament of the Bible. And the psalms are songs of David, King David. And those were involved in Vespers. There would be some certain what we call office hymns. Now, I'm not talking about an office like I'm sitting in my office, but each one of those seven times of prayer are called an office inside what's called the Liturgy of the Hours. So Vespers, Compline, then we had Terce, None, Prime. I know I'm missing a few, but anyway, it's testing my time back in college. They would have certain hymns that would go with each, you know, office. And then during different seasons, so maybe it was during Lent, or maybe it was during Advent in this case, there would be a certain hymn. And we'll talk about in a little bit, we have a certain anthem, a certain hymn that we're using in the new version, this new Covenant Advent Vespers that Alexis composed, that traditionally was sung during Advent back over the centuries. And then finally, there was something called a canticle. So a canticle is usually taken from the Bible. It's a song in the Bible that is usually said by a major character. And the canticle for Vespers is what we call the Magnificat, or the Song of Mary. And that is the song in Luke, the Gospel of Luke, where Mary finds out after she visits her cousin Elizabeth, she goes to tell her that, hey, I'm having a baby. And guess what? It's going to be the Son of God. And Elizabeth is astonished. Elizabeth is probably 50, 60 years older than Mary. And she says to Mary, guess what? I'm going to have a baby too. And Mary is so overjoyed. She basically says this song called the Magnificat. My soul doth magnify the Lord. And my spirit rejoices in God, my Savior. And it goes on to talk about how this baby, this person that I'm going to give birth to is going to cast down the mighty from their seats. The poor are going to be raised up. So lots of things there. So Vespers has a format. Over history, throughout music history, there have been, it's been developed, right? So it was pretty much the same throughout the Renaissance into the Baroque. But then as we go further into, let's say, the classical period with people like Mozart, Haydn, their contemporaries, then going further to the Romantic, early Romantic, you have Schubert, Beethoven. Things started to drift away from being church-centric only. And they incorporated, while they still composed for the church, Vespers were sung in church, but you didn't have those grand settings as you used to. You did to an extent, but it wasn't like it was during the Renaissance. You would have instrumentation, you would have an orchestra, and usually it was big and grand for big occasions and big events. When we get into the modern times, 20th century, and even current times, it's almost like no holds bars. So the idea of Vespers can be completely put on its head, right? And one thing we'll mention when I start to share in a little bit, I'm going to share little snippets of historical music, musical examples from what you know music would have been like in different periods from Vespers. We have the Church of England. So they still now, if you go over to England or, you know, any Anglican church, so they do something called choral evensong. And choral evensong is, in a nutshell, evening prayer or Vespers, but also part of the next time of prayer from the monastic community called compline, sort of smushed together. And you'll find in that beautiful service another canticle, which we're going to talk about, or I'm going to play a little bit of an example for, called the Nunc Dimittis, or the Song of Simeon. Basically, when Jesus was presented to the temple in the Gospel of Luke, Simeon was a priest, and God would not let him die. He lived to be 100, and I don't know what the exact number was, but he was quite mature, let's say. And when he saw Jesus and met him in the temple, he knew that he was the Messiah, and he uttered this song: Lord, now let thy servant depart in peace according to thy word, for my eyes have seen thy salvation, a light to the Gentiles and the glory of your people Israel. That's a paraphrase. So before I share a couple pieces, what we did, and Alexis will talk about it a little bit more, is I took roughly the liturgy of Vespers, and I said to Alexis, I like these texts, I want to keep the liturgy, but I want you to make it your own. Add some instruments. We don't have to use the exact texts. And you'll see it sort of keeps that ancient feel and flow of the service, but it also at the same time has a very modern, different feel to it. And I hope you'll join via Facebook, or it'll be the following week on YouTube on our Facebook page, which I'll make sure I share or Brenton shares. So one thing I want to do now is, what does that music historically sound like? What did certain parts of Vespers? And so we're going to highlight some of those. And I'm about to share my screen. So let's see here. So I'm going to share, and I'm not going to play the whole piece because we'd be here till 10 o'clock, and we don't need that. But I'm going to share a couple different pieces going on here. So the first thing I want to share is a piece. This comes from the late Renaissance, even early Baroque, and it's by a person named John Blow. He was English, and this is a setting of Psalm 141. And the psalm basically says, Lord, let my prayer come up into thy sight as incense. So part of Vespers is and not every, we're not doing this on Sunday, but more so back in, you know, in the Catholic Church and in ancient times, incense would have been lit and lights, candles would have been lit. And this was a piece that John Blow wrote for this specific point in that service. So take a listen. So that's very refined, very clean, very reserved. That was written, again, late 1600s, early 1700s in England. So now what I'm going to share is completely different. And this was written probably later or in the 1700s. Early 1700s, but later, a contemporary of John Blow, maybe a little bit later. And this is by an Italian composer named Claudio Monteverdi. And you may be familiar with this piece if you're familiar with choral music. But I'm only going to play the very beginning. This is from his very famous Vespers of 1610. So I apologize there. He is actually late Renaissance, early Baroque. He lived through the Baroque period, and he may have crossed time. I don't know the exact date of John Blow, but what I want you to hear on this piece in particular is how different it is from that other piece. And this would have been the opening sentence. So it says on my screen, Deus in agitorum. We're not going to get to the Dixi Dominus, but it basically means, oh God, make haste to help us. Lord, make haste to save us. So listen to this.
Oh,
So much, much grander, very different. Pomp and circumstance, joy, very ornate. And one thing to note, that piece, the opening, Monteverdi actually also reused for his opera, Orfeo, the story of Orpheus and Eurydice. And it was actually the first opera, first modern opera of modern time. So if we look back and say, hey, what is the first opera ever really written, the real opera, Orfeo? And he uses that in both his secular and sacred music. So I don't want to, you know, obviously for sake of time, I'm going to show you one or two more quick parts. I'm just going to show you a little bit of this one. This would have been another one of the psalms written during Vespers, but this is Mozart. So listen again how different this piece is from something that Monteverdi wrote or John Blow wrote.
Thank you.
So this piece, much different, right? Not as, obviously the instrument, the instrumentation is different. More modern instruments in Mozart's time. And it has soloists, just like we would say Monteverdi's setting of Vespers are, but it's much more what I would say is angular, linear, very different. And to come to church and hear a whole setting of Vespers or one of his masses with full orchestra, how amazing would that have been in one of those cathedrals in Salzburg? So the last thing I'm gonna share with you now before we listen to Alexis talk is we're gonna move all the way to the 20th century and even the 21st century with one of my favorite composers. It's completely different from what we've heard. But I mentioned that Vespers or choral evensong in the Anglican Church ties in a canticle. So one of those songs, that Song of Simeon, the Nunc Dimittis. And we also are having that in our Vespers this Sunday, premiering this Sunday, we are having a setting of the Nunc Dimittis. What I want you to hear now is a setting. I'm only going to play a little bit of it by an Estonian composer named Ervo Pärt. And Ervo Pärt is well known for using voices in what's called tintinnabula. And the voices sound so crisp and so clear that you close your eyes and almost picture like they're bells, or it's very, very sustained and clear. So this is his setting of Nunc Dimittis. And listen again, picture how different this is. I can't imagine that a setting like this would actually be sung in the context of a church service or like a liturgical Vespers. It could be. I could be completely wrong, and it has been. But just listen to a minute or so of this piece.
Thank you.
very different piece. But again, something based on Vespers evening prayer. So you've heard about what Vespers is, where it came from. You've listened to some musical examples that over history have developed out of the idea of evening prayer and song evening prayer. And we'll sort of end this lecture with Alexis Ward, our commission composer, talking about her process, how she composed it. So I'm going to load her up here and let's listen to her. And then afterwards, we'll take a few minutes. And if you have some questions, you can ask, feel free to ask.
Hi, my name is Alexis Ward, and I am the commissioned composer for the Covenant Advent Vespers piece commissioned by Ryan Pryslak from Presbyterian Church of the Covenant that will be premiered this coming Sunday on December 12th in Wilmington, Delaware. I've brought you today to one of my many offices. This is the sanctuary of Trinity Presbyterian Church, and I am actually going to spend some time talking a little bit about the compositional process and some of the behind the scenes for this piece. We're near the sanctuary's piano, so I can hopefully even play a few excerpts for you today as we kind of take a look behind the scenes. The commission actually came about many, many months ago. Started, of course, as they always do with the conversation. Ryan and I had talked about a project that he had in mind. Probably our earliest conversations happened early last summer. And he told me a little bit about his vision for the service and his vision for this new work that he would be bringing to life. And so really, we just worked through all the nitty gritty early on. We have to talk about instrumentation and voicing and what are we setting, right? What is the liturgical context of the piece? Some of the movements in this work are congregational and others are more of a concert work. And so they're more performance based. Ryan was also very specific about the kinds of texts or lyrics that he wanted, and even the translations of some of those texts, which was very, very helpful. And he had some really neat ideas about the types of instruments and colors that he wanted incorporated in the work, into the work. And so we talked about all of that and kind of worked through all of those details very, very early on. I was excited to do a piece for Advent because it is one of my absolute favorite times of the liturgical calendar year. Probably that and Lent are my two favorite seasons. And so certainly the materials that you have to work with as far as liturgy and text go are just very rich and beautiful. So it's really not too difficult to get inspired by those times for me. So once we kind of had a lot of that nailed down, that's sort of the point at which Ryan kind of hands all of this over to me with a great deal of trust, I might add. And it's just sort of left up to the creative process. I always, when I'm writing new music, particularly for choir, always want to spend a lot of time with the text. So what I'll often do is I have a notebook where I will write out the text by hand many, many times. And I'll do it in different you know, pen and pencil. I'll try to write the text really big, I'll write it really small. So I'll have written out the text by hand quite a few times. And as I'm doing that, it kind of, and I'm sort of speaking it in my head, I'm trying to see where some of the text inflection falls, what are some of the more important lines of text that need to be emphasized more than others. And then all of a sudden, things like dynamics and phrasing start to speak to me from the page. And so you'll see in my notebook that I have a bunch of nonsensical scribbles that have all sorts of notes and notations. So it'll have the poetry or the scripture or whatever text it is that I'm using, with a lot of scribbles and doodles and dynamic markings and underlinings. And I'll take that as sort of my first step. And once I bring it to the piano, because this is usually where I like to write from, is from the piano. I am a pianist, and so this is kind of like where I feel very comfortable writing most of this music, I'll take all of those scribbles and I'll have them as a reference point, sort of as a skeleton that starts me off. For the Covenant Advent Vespers, what's curious about the piece, it's seven movements. One of them is congregational. And so, of course, my approach in composing that piece was much different than some of the others. It was important that the melody that I created for the congregation was accessible because they, of course, don't have the music in front of them, or maybe the congregation, many members may not read music themselves, and so it has to be something that they hear once or twice and can pick up on very easily. And so for that, Ryan had chosen the text from Psalm 141, and I spent some time just singing through the text on different melodies. I loved D minor as a key. I love minor keys for Advent. I think it really emphasizes the mystery and wonder of the season. And so just came up with a melody just like this, right, in D minor, and it sounds like. The text is, let my prayer arise in thy sight as incense, and the lifting up of my hands be an evening sacrifice. And I felt that the most important part of that line was the lifting up of my hands, and you can kind of hear that's where the phrase peaks, right, where I felt that the text was most important and needed to be emphasized. And then throughout the piece, it is met with, you know, that continued refrain with responses from the choir, which are a bit more prayerful, right? The whole setting of the text is, let my prayer arise. So it has sort of a muted tones. Another movement that I'd love to talk about is the Rorate Cheli. This is the only movement that we're doing in Latin. I especially requested this because the vision that I had for this piece, the Rorate Cheli text, is very old. And the sort of the sounds that I was hearing as I familiarized myself with the text was Gregorian chant, right? And so some of the text throughout this features a soprano who is almost chanting throughout the piece. It's supposed to be very mysterious, again with that word, mysterious. But even just setting this first few words, Rorate Cheli, drop down ye heavens. I did a little bit of text painting here, so the music kind of mimics what the text is saying. And so I felt that sort of a dropping motion or dropping motive would sound appropriate. So it opens like this in the words Rorate Cheli. Line falls. And kind of has those darker, mysterious sounds throughout. And then again, sort of painted with this chant from the soprano, which I thought worked really, really well for this text. And it's a gorgeous, gorgeous, gorgeous Latin text that I think is just beautiful to have during the Advent season. The piece itself is just sort of this yearning, longing, I don't want to say begging, but imploring, right? It's a text speaking of the Jews who are waiting for Messiah. They're saying, come, send Messiah, save us from our captivity. We are waiting in great anticipation for this miracle that you've promised. And so many of the phrases kind of have this sort of tension and release feel as they're sort of yearning for the coming of Messiah, as we all are during the Advent time as we're waiting for the coming of Christmas. Of course, the difference is we know the ending to the story, but certainly in the context of when this text is supposed to have been spoken or uttered, of course, they don't know that. They're in the period of waiting. They're in the thick of anticipation and longing. And so that was sort of the colors that I was going for in this piece. contrastingly, one of the bigger movements in this piece is the Hail Gladdening Light text. It's also a very old traditional Latin text, the Fos Hilaron. But of course, this is Hail Gladdening Light, of his pure glory poured, who is the immortal Father, heavenly, blessed, holies of holies, Jesus Christ our Lord. It's proclamatory. It's full of praise and exclamation. And so in writing down that text, I kind of heard something much more triumphant. And so some of the colors that we have here kind of sound like this. And it's in 6/8, and so it has a nice dance and lilt to it. And as Ryan and I discussed very early on, this movement was to happen in a portion of the service where this is the first time that the lights come on. It is probably the most triumphant portion of the service, and so the instruments are doing a great deal to support that proclamation. They're playing at all ends of their ranges. You have a great deal of percussion. We added in handbell choir to kind of reinforce the joyful end that we're kind of getting across with this piece. And I just really had a lot of fun with some of the colors and textures with the instrumentation. We of course have a string ensemble. We have woodwinds that have very challenging 16th and 32nd note runs throughout a lot of the transitions of this movement. And the percussion itself, we have a lot of bass drum and tom-tom, so reinforcing a driving rhythm throughout, which I think is very fun. Overall, as far as all seven of these movements coming together into one, I think the important thing for both the composer and commissioner alike is to make sure that we understand what are some of the pervasive themes of the work. Certainly this is all for Advent, and all of the texts are about anticipation. And again, as I mentioned earlier, we as listeners, we know the end of the story, but many of these texts are from the perspective of Mary, the Virgin Mary, or Simeon, or the Jewish people, who are all kind of in the midst of the story themselves, faced with really challenging circumstances, or Mary, for example, who's being told that she is with child. These are huge revelations that, you know, come with a great deal of anxiety and anticipation, but also a great deal of hope, because they know what has been promised to them through these prophecies and through even this movement I talked about here. Just they understand that there's a bigger story here. So I hope that was a nice little behind the scenes for the Covenant Advent Vespers. Very excited to hear this come to life.
So, yeah, you know, we're very excited about Sunday. It was fun. Just such a neat experience working with Alexis to commission this. Brenton, you know, you got to sing it a little bit on Sunday for rehearsal. It's going to be a really cool experience. And if, you know, obviously if you're not able to get there in person, I'll make sure Brenton has our Facebook and YouTube link so you can watch it after the fact. But I think that's about it for me. If you have any questions, I'm happy to try to answer them. Or we can send them to Alexis and answer them after the fact. But Brenton, thank you guys for having me and Alexis tonight.
Let's give him a hand. Great job. Woo! All right. Well, thank you, Ryan. I have a couple questions, but before I have one question before we give it to the residents. Just talk to me a little bit about your church and a little bit about what inspired you to bring this piece to an Advent service to your church's perspective.
It's a great question. So Church of the Covenant is in the sort of the more of the suburban part of Wilmington. And it's in an area called Bellefonte and also near an area called Edgemoor. Bellefonte is sort of middle class area, but Edgemoor itself also is low income. And we have a very close ties with Edgemoor. We have an after-school program called Edge that is for at-risk children. We have something called Melody, which is a program teaching young kids how to play violin and cello for free. So one of the things that when we tie in our Arts of Covenant series is we look at how can we continue to outreach to the community. You know, many places have concert series just for the sake of having a concert series. But one of the things we do is look for sort of that mission and that what do we want to see from this. And one of the missions of the Arts of Covenant is to support local musicians, to have their voices heard, and also to support sort of the minority voices. So female composers, composers, Black, Indigenous people of color, even LGBTQ composers. And so that's sort of where this stemmed from. You know, Alexis is a local, phenomenal female composer and wanted to give her the ability to, you know, have a larger work that she hasn't composed before. So that's where that comes from, I think.
That's great. That's great. Really, really honored and privileged. And then the other question I have is, where did we meet? Could you answer that for the people? I know we both.
Where you and I met.
How did
contact? Yeah. So it's funny because it feels like you and I have been, we've known each other forever now. You're such a great guy, Brenton. And I really appreciate your friendship and you know, your collegiality. We met through friends that are with the Wilmington Concert Opera. And Kristen or Kirsten Kunkel and
Kirsten Kunkel.
They wanted to, we were doing a concert or something and you were part of the concert and then that we were having for our summer concert series and the rest is history. You kept coming and singing.
And actually what really happened too was I was asked to sing a recital with Wilmington Concert Opera. And I was like, I need a rehearsal space. I need somewhere to rehearse and I need somewhere where I can sing, you know? And I Kirsten Kunkel said, oh, I know this guy, you're going to love him. And he, trust me, he's going to use you. And so we came in contact and you graciously allowed us to practice. I mean, we were there late nights rehearsing. I know a friend of ours, Kyla, did her opera there as well and for her senior recital. And it just kind of grew from there. Hey, can you use, we have a concert. We did Daniel Pinkham's Pentecost Cantata. And then we did some summer series, and then singing at your church a few times. And so it's been a pleasure. Yeah. And that hopefully the friendship will blossom. And I love your church. I love people at your church. And I love what you're doing at Covenant. It's really quite a joy. All right, any questions from the residents? Okay, here is one. Here you go.
Hi.
Hi there.
My question is, your choir, are they all trained singers?
That's a great question. So normally my church choir would not. I have a volunteer church choir. However, since COVID's happened, it's been very difficult for my regular volunteer church choir to get together, and it's a smaller congregation. But the choir that's singing on Sunday is a mixture of professional singers that we've brought in for this event, some volunteer musicians that are doing handbells and other things, and then we have 8 choral scholars that Alexis works with from the University of Delaware. So
the singers for Sunday
are all trained. We have some professional musicians and we have some singers, choral singers from the University of Delaware. But we also have some of my singers and handbell ringers from my church that are just amateur. They do it for love of music. So a little bit of everything. in the mix there. So are you saying you want to come down and sing?
I can't sing anymore. I sang in my church choir for about 50 some odd years.
That's one amazing.
I love it. I mean, I miss my choir so much.
You love singing.
Yes, I do. But I've had some surgeries on my neck, and it's messed.
Understood.
Messed my voice up.
Well, I hope you'll listen to the service on Sunday.
We will play it next week. Yeah, we'll make sure that I'll make sure they'll listen to it. So great question, Jones. Do you have a question, Alan? I'm sure you do. Our choral chief
I have a couple of questions.
Yes.
Okay.
Basically, one of the things was, I was a little surprised when we're talking about the canticle as a poetic form starting much later. I thought that the poetic form really existed much earlier among the Jews. And they form, coming out of Exodus, they were struck where they couldn't really perform their religious rites. And so they formed the Psalms, which would literally list the promises of God as they felt that they were. And they had a ritual each evening where they would repeat them first halves. And that form was the canticle then. And then this existed for some length of time. And then from what your discourse here, you said that the money of the prayers, the vespers that existed among the monastic groups would take seven times a day formed basically in responses to that kind of feeling. And I was apparently that holds together. I was just trying to understand the transition. I can understand, you know, the people coming out of slavery clinging to, you know, what is their God? They have a theological basis even for their government. So this is how they expressed it in the Psalms. And later, Moses dictated literally the Pentateuch to the scribes that became the first five books of the Bible. And then later the songs that you were describing here broke into sort of a response type thing where, you know, the leader would say something and then the congregation would respond. So they're trying to form a dialogue back and forth between the people, but they were really, it was almost just a confirmation. I was trying to figure out, can I form a group of how a form of how this transmission of spirituality of the people is being expressed by this. And it seems to me very much when I hear the different pieces that you're showing over several hundred years, it's almost like a baby trying to learn to talk with the God of a supreme intelligence. You know, we're trying to form, you know, how can we form a conversation that is both meaningful to God and also satisfies our own souls, you know? And it seems like we're still in that same kind of mode. We're trying to figure out what can we say that is meaningful. This is the way I'm beginning to form sort of an understanding of the transition of music, the vocal music over all these years. And I think that makes sense to you.
I think it would be. I think we could have a whole nother lecture or five lectures on, you know, spirituality and, you know, music and just sort of that history of how different I don't want to say religious types, but different periods in music history, you know, put forth spirituality, right? I think that even during the, you know, the Renaissance and the medieval ages, they used, it was more structured. While there was structure back in the time of Moses and Miriam and, you know, all those, the church fathers there, I think it just, there's an evolution, right? That has to do with also the time and the place that those composers are in. So the society, I think, has to do a lot with it, with how that transition happens and what the needs are during that period. But that we'd have to have a whole bunch of other lectures to really cover all that in depth.
Okay. Now, I feel better. I think I'm in the early stages of trying to form this idea, and it seems to, I think I can patch this together a little bit, so that, and it seems to fit. Thank you.
Oh, awesome.
It's my very good. Thank you. Do you have a question?
Yeah.
No. All right. Well, you know, this is what I want to do, because I know it's late for everybody, but this is what I'm hoping, and I'll put you on the spot, Ryan and Alexis, but what my hope is I know that today was more focused on Vespers, right? Just the regular Vespers theme. And we've talked about that at Friends Home, kind of the history of the church as well, and played a variety of Vespers, one of them being a setting of Ave Maria, how that's changed.
Yep.
So what we would like to do sometime is when we do record it for the very first time, I would like to actually spend time with you and Alexis again, and we'll spend time the whole lecture on Alexis' piece by hearing snippets.
Yeah.
Of her piece, because we haven't performed it yet. So it's kind of, we're putting Alexis on the spot because it's never been performed before. But we'd like to have a part two, at least a part two with both of you and Alexis there. We'll find a time some evening. We'll get all our musician schedules together and do that if that's okay with you guys.
Yeah. Sure.
But really wonderful. I mean, it's just in depth. And I knew, especially with Advent, and we focus on this season of, you know, hope and wonder and mystery and just so much liturgy behind Vespers. And I think you did a wonderful job explaining, you know, the lecture, like a wonderful lecture on how Vespers were designed and through many time periods. Thank you. We want to give you a hand. Thank you.
Well, I enjoyed it and happy to come back again after.
Yes, you want to thank it?
I want to thank you because this is a very first time that I've ever seen any of the story of the early church and these choirs. And it's, but I thank you very much.
Well, it's my pleasure to help you learn a little bit more about that. And, you know, hopefully you'll learn some more in the future. There's so much out there you can.
There's so much to learn. Even at whatever age we are, we can always, always learn. So thank you, Ryan. We will have Ryan and Alexis join us again sometime. I hope it will be before the spring. We'll have to get our schedules together. It'd be kind of crazy to play Advent stuff in April. So maybe in February, maybe in January, we'll fit you in somewhere. It might be good January, February, because then it's a little bit before Lenten season, and we're not going to be able to play it during Advent season, unfortunately. So thank you. Let's give him a hand. And Alexis.
Thanks. Thank you guys, and happy holidays to everyone.
Thank you, Ryan.
Okay.
And to you as well, absolutely. So thank you. So our next lecture will be on opera. And one of my voice teachers from college, his name is Robert Iacoviello, and it's an opera that I'm doing called Pagliacci. And there's another Italian opera, and we will be presenting now opera music for the next lecture. Until then, thank you so much for watching. And until then, blessings to you all. And I hope you continue to watch these series.